Okay, today we are going to start AOP, then JPA. JPA, more concept of the JPA. Okay, first we'll start with AOP, aspect oriented programming. Aspect oriented programming, it provides a solution to implement cross-cutting concern. What is the meaning of cross-cutting concern? Okay, what we can achieve using AOP in our Spring Boot application. Whenever we develop application, any application, it has a multiple layers, right? It has multiple layers, web layer, business layer, DOA layer, proxy layer, like that we have multiple layers. Then when execute each layer, we need to log something. That is a basic example. We need to do some transaction, we need to log, we need to validate. There are a lot of There are a lot of common activity available. Those common activity we need to repeat. We need to repeat each and every layer. We need to repeat that the same activity each and every layer. For example, logging. Let's say logging. Whenever I execute one method from web layer, I want to know what time that method is executed, which method is executed, what is the signature. So I want to capture those data in my log file. I want to capture those data in log file. The similar in the web application, everybody will do that. So not a web application, general project, everybody log that information, right? For tracking purpose. If there is an issue, we can go and open the log. We can find out the issue. For tracking purpose, we log the data. What's happening in the behind the scene. Whenever execute a web layer, I want to print some log statement. Whenever execute a business layer, I want to print that log. For the DAO also same thing. For this purpose, what you have to do? We have to do the print statement. It's a logger.info. We have to logger.info, logger.error. Some log statement will go into print based on our need. Okay. This activity, right? We need to repeat everywhere. This activity, we need to repeat everywhere. It's kind of duplication. Also, it's a today I started on project, okay, web application. I have not doing any log activity. Just I am returning the methods. Now I want to. I want in certain time of period after 1 month, 2 months, people are saying, hey, you need to log. You are not doing any log statement here. So we need to open all the classes. We need to do the log statement. The same thing we need to do. So it's kind of repetitive task. Also, it's not a maintainable code. Not looks very neat. I want to this kind of common activity. I want to make it in separate place. I want to make it more generic. Then I can reuse that wherever I need. I want to reuse that wherever I need. I want to do like this. If you want to do like this, we have to use AOP, aspect oriented programming. It's provide the cross-cutting concern. That is some common activity. We can make it more generic. We can use that wherever you need. Okay. Now we're going to see some examples how to implement in Spring Boot application. If you want to do that, first we need to add one artifact. This is the artifact you need to add. Spring Boot Starter AOP. As you need, if you want to add any module, if you want to implement any module in a Spring Boot application, we have to add that respective starter project. Starter project, nothing but it's a dependency. That dependency we need to add. Here I added Spring Boot Starter -AOP. Okay. Then, so customer service. In the customer service, right, I have defined a system.out.println customer service save starts, customer service save ends, like that get all, customer service save starts, customer not get all, sorry, get all ends. So like this is a very small project, right? But if you have hundreds of classes, the same thing we need to repeat all the places. Now I want to move this kind of code in a single place. I want to reuse that wherever I need. So for that purpose, we can use a AOP. To implement a AOP, we need to create one class. In that class, we have to implement. Then that class we can used. There are some concepts in EOP. Before implementing, we'll check that those concepts. After understanding, we'll start implementing. What is aspect? Aspect is nothing but using aspect, we can implement the common task generically. Common task generically. There is a point cut, advice, join point. You need to understand these three concepts. What is point cut? What is advice? What is join point? Point cut, nothing but it's an expression. It's kind of expression. Through that expression, you can tell where you want to log the particular statement. Through that statement, you can tell where you want to log the particular statement. That is the EOP provides an expression. Through that expression, we have to tell. We need to tell, hey, go to this class, go to this package. Under print the statement, we have to tell that. That is the purpose of point cut. Whatever expression that here I am saying, execution star com.itgodot.service. Go to service package. Go to service package. Whatever classes available there. Star means whatever classes available there. Go there. Inside that class. Again star. Whatever methods available inside a particular class. Go on the print particular statement. This is the expression. We can say through point cut. We can say execute whatever you want in this particular class. Whatever classes available, whatever methods available in the particular service package. That is called as a point cut. Then advice. There is a three type of advice. Before advice, after advice, and around. There is a three type of advice. Before advice, after advice, and around. Through the point cut, I am saying that execute the particular statement. Execute the particular statement from this method I am saying. Through advice, I can tell, we can advise to that point cut. When do you want to execute? Whether before executing that particular method. Which method? This method, right? I want to do something before executing this method. Before executing this method, I want to do something that we can say through advice. Before executing, execute this statement. After executing this method, execute this statement. Before, after, around. Around means not a before, not after. It's around. Around. If you want, for example, if you want after executing this particular method, before executing this particular method, I want to do something. Around meaning before executing, we are doing something. After executing, we are doing something. Both executed, I want to do something. In that case, you can use around. Okay. Then join point. What is join point? Whatever you have seen, right? Advice, point cut, before, after. These things are design time, right? Whenever you define a particular aspect, we are defining. I want to execute this particular statement through this expression. I want to execute this particular statement in this class, in this package. That is your design time itself is defined using point cut. Using that advices, there is some annotation at before, at after, at around. Using the annotation before executing, that not runtime, the compile time itself, we're saying I wanted to perform this particular code before executing this method. Something you are going specific, something you are going defining at the compile time itself. But join point not that. Based on this definition, based on point cut, based on advice, join point holds some information at the runtime. Join point holds some information at the runtime. That information we can utilize. That information we can utilize. That we're going to see part of the implementation. Okay, that we're going to see part of the implementation. Okay, now the join point. If you want, here is the implementation. Before method is nothing but it's a simple method, right? It's a simple method. In that simple method, I have annotated one annotation called at before. At before, here I am saying com.itgarden.service.customerservice.customerservice.star. Inside a customer service, whatever method we have, that method should whenever execute that method, whenever execute those method, whatever methods available inside a customer service, whenever execute that method, before that I want to print this statement, because I am saying at before. Because I am saying at before. Since I am saying at before, this expression execute, this expression go to inside the customer service, whatever methods available, before executing that method, this particular statement get executed. That is called as at before. Now I am going to comment out all the things. I don't want to print everything. Just understanding purpose, I'll going to say before method. Okay. I'll run this application. I'll going to say server.port equal to, because I have a Docker, it's running. You give some problem. Okay. 80 9081. Okay. Okay, now started the application. I have a controller class. There is an add customer. Add customer called the customer service.save. It will do this logic and return the customer object. I am not saving the actually. Intention of this example is we need to see how to work, how to aspect is behaving. That we need to see, right? So just I am executing some logic. That logic, after executing that logic, I am returning the customer object. That's it. This particular method I am calling inside a controller classes. Okay, if you want to just call this controller classes, I need to use api/customers. api/customers, opening a Postman. Okay, now I'm going to execute the statement. What happened? Oh, the port number is wrong. I given port number 9091, right? That's the reason. Okay. I'm going to say port numbers. Now got executed. See here, before method. See, it's printing before method. 1 minute. I'm going to comment on this also. It executed a before method. Simple statement I am saying, it's a before method. Okay, now I want to execute after method. So before method, first before method executed, then after method executed, because I'm using here after annotation. Once you notice here, here I'm saying customer service dot star. That meaning I want to print, I want to execute this statement, whatever methods available inside a customer service. Execute one, the whatever methods available in the customer service, those method, before executing those method, this particular print statement execute. But here I am saying IT garden dot service star dot star. That meaning whatever classes available inside the package, whatever classes available inside the package, each classes there are many method, right? After executing method, after executing those method, I want to print this statement. Okay, Then next example is return. There is another advice I forgot to say. It's after return. After return means okay, method executed. Then if your method returning some value, right? If your method returns after successful return, I want to execute some code. I want to do some process. I want to do some activity. That time you can use a after returning. After returning. Here when use the after returning annotation, we have to say we have to pass two argument. We have to pass two argument. One is a value equal to the point get expression. Then returning equal to that returning name. Returning equal to returning name. This particular this variable this name must match with the second argument. In the after method returning, this is my own method name. This method name can be anything. Okay, after method returning, I'm saying join point, comma, object result. This name must be matched. Okay, now this particular thing hold the this result object holds what the value returned by the particular method. What is the value returned by the particular method? Okay, that value available here. Here I'm saying, let's say I'll go to okay, either whenever invoke a add customer, sorry, whenever invoke a save customer, returning customer object, right? This customer object invoked by after executing this method, this return a customer object, that customer object returned here. That customer object returned here. Here I am saying some condition result dot instance customer, then get the customer object. Else get the list object. Why? Because when you look at the customer service, there is a two method, right? Get all and a save. Save method return always one customer object. Get all always return list of customer object. So return type is different. Okay, this is a list. This is a customer object. So we'll when you use this without checking, you will get that typecast exception. To avoid that exception, I am saying result instance of customer, then convert that as a customer object. Print that data. If it is list. Converting that as a list object, then I am printing that list name. Okay. As of now, there is no value. When I call the get all method, there is no value, right? That's the reason nothing is printing here. When you look at here, that after returning, I am saying system.out.println join point. I told right, join point will have a runtime information. It's not a descendant. It's not a descendant purpose. It's a runtime. It holds a runtime information. I want to get from the join point. I want to get signature.getName. Get signature.getName. That meaning it's return. Name of the method join point join point return join point prints this entire statement. See here, then I am saying get name join point get signature of get name return get all, then colon I am saying end. This entire thing get printed here. Using join point we can get the meta information of particular method. That is the purpose of join point. Using join point, I can tell this method executed, this method execution completed. Like that, once you specified here, that's it. You don't have to write a log statement each and every class. Just you have to define here, that's it. Whatever method executing from the package, automatically this part get execute and print. That is the main purpose of AOP. Here, I am printing the since I'm executing get all method, come to else block, I'm trying to print that value. As of now, there is no value, right? That's the reason it's not printing. If you want to print this data, we need to execute the add method. Add method got executed now. Then I'm going to execute the get method. See the Suresh is printed because I am passing here Suresh. Name is Suresh. I am printing here customer.getName. Okay. So this is the purpose of after returning value. Okay. Now I will go into comment this. I will go into uncomment this block. I'll going to uncomment this block. Or not this. Okay, this is not. I want to uncomment this. Okay. Now here before method and after method I uncommented. What will happen? Whenever any method executes from the customer service, before executing that method, did part execute. It says the particular class name, then method name starts. Method name and starts. This is logger.info not prepared because I'm not using the logger.info here. Just I'm using system.out.println. So I'm keeping system.out.println. Then join points dot get auth. From the join points I can get the what are the arguments, what is the parameter of particular method that is executing, I can take all the parameters, I can take the all the method parameters. Here I am printing the parameters. Okay, then it will print before method. I'll going to keep this method. Okay, now whenever I execute any method from the customer service, it will going to print that method name, and then this particular statement return the all the parameters. Then I'm that parameter I'm going to print it using for loop here. Then after method, the after method similarly like that, after execution of the particular method from the customer service, I'm saying an after method. Then here I'm printing name of the method and the class name. It's a get method, right? Okay, that's fine. So you're giving them which class and which method. Get all starts. After that, which class and which method. It's printing. So this thing automatically will happen. Whatever method executed based on your expression. Based on the expression, it will go to the corresponding package or corresponding classes. It will execute all the methods. So through this way, we can make it more generic in our logging framework. Okay. Then I'll going to see one more advice around. I'll keep it around. Where is around? Before, after. This around is for special purpose. For example, let's say after executing method, before executing method, after executing method, I want to do some useful operation. I want to do some useful operation based on my requirement. For let's say after saving, I want to log the statement after completion of saving. That meaning after executing, complete executing, I want to log some information. In such a case, we can go with around. Okay. In this case, the around method, we have to pass proceeding join point. Proceeding join point, I will tell what is the purpose of that. Okay, here I am saying proceed join point dot proceed. Let's comment out this. Let's see what's happening. Okay. Now I have a before, after, and the around. Three advices I have. I'll go to execute post method. See, I can see here, I can execute only around. After and before is not executed. If you want to execute only around, we should not use this. This won't allow to execute after and before. When you say join point at proceed, then it will allow to execute after and before. Now it's uncommented. Now I'm going to execute this, restart the application. Now you can see after method everything get executed. This starts, this is ends, this is a before, this is a after, then around. Around actually execute after executing a before and after, then around execute. If you don't want to execute around before and after, just you have to, we should not use this particular line. Okay, if you use this line, this around execute after executing after and before. Okay, this is based on your requirement, your scenario, we can use it around. Okay, this is all about the aspect J. Using aspect J, we can make it a common task in a one places. We can reuse that across your application. That is the purpose of AOP. There are many expressions are available. I will going to give that expression, list out the expression. I will share this in the group. Okay. Okay, now we're going to focus on some more information about the JPA. Okay. This is no need. Okay. Okay, so far we have seen some small example only, like JPA. We have seen small example to how to do the CRUD operation. It's a simple object. We are using customer object. Using customer object, we did some CRUD operation. Now we are planning to focus on some complex object. How to do the CRUD operation? Complex object. Okay. For complex object meaning, it has a multiple relationship. One object can have a more than 3-table, 4-table relationship. In such a kind of object, I want to do CRUD operation using JPA. Before moving to that, what is JPA? What is CyberNet? Why we are using JPA? There is a multiple term terminals, right? JPA and CyberNet. What is that? What is different between JPA and CyberNet? First, we need to get clear on that. Okay. This is my DB program. This is my DB program. This DB program using a JPA. JPA. Java Persistent API. It's using Java Persistent API to handle the CRUD operation. Correct? Now, what is the role of CyberNet here? That we need to understand, right? Then you can say CyberNet. Here it's CyberNet. See, JPA is a, only have a specification. Okay, JPA does not have any implementation. JPA does not have any implementation to perform DB manipulation. CyberNet is a provider, implementation provider. It has an API to map with our database table through objects. Through the Java objects, we can map. We can map with a particular database table. Through that, we can manipulate the DML operation. It could be a delete or update or save, select, whatever thing we can do. CyberNet is a persistent framework. Through that, we can manipulate our DB data in object-oriented manner. That is the purpose of CyberNet. CyberNet have a full implementation. JPA is having some specification. It has some specification. It's saying, I want this particular API. It has some definition. From that specification, for that specification, CyberNet having implementation. CyberNet is having implementation. Whenever you call save method, whenever you call delete method, that is actually called from CyberNet API. It's not implemented in JPA. See, why we need like this? Let's say if you have a JPA, here I'm using JPA. Tomorrow, suddenly I don't want to use CyberNet. I want to go with some other persistent technology like iBatis. There are many persistent technology. I want to switch. In this case, I can switch from CyberNet to iBatis. Top link. These are some persistent framework. If you want to switch, you can switch. But still, your program using the JPA. Okay, JPA is a specification. It's use specification. That specification implementation available in Hibernate. This is the difference between JPA and Hibernate. Okay. Now, clear, right? Now we'll go to our implementation. What we're going to see in our in today's example. This is a database model I have designed for this example, our JPA examples. It's kind of a user management or customer user management or employee management, whatever you can name it. It has a user table. User table having an ID, email, password, first name and last name. Okay. Then I want to use customer and employee data. I want to use customer employee data in my company. Let's say I am having a sales company. In the sales company, lot of customer will come. Also, the sales company have an employee. Both the person as a user. Both the person is a user. Okay. User. But based on his attribute. For example, in the sales company, one person, one user joined. That person, that user is a employee. One person buying something from the sales company is a customer. So, user is a two category. One is a customer, another one is an employee. User will have an address table, right? So, every user have an address table. Then, all user having some default role. All user having a default role. Employee having some role. Using that role, he can manipulate their application. Customer having some role. Using that role, he cannot manipulate their application. They have some only limited access. Okay. Now, in this particular model I want to design. So, user table. In the user table, I want to add address. So address having multiple columns. Right? So I come up with separate address column. So sorry, separate address table. This is a user is a one, address is a many. One user can have a multiple address. One user can have a multiple address. Office address, then residential address, like that. One user can have a multiple address. This is a one to many relationship. User to address is a one to many relationship. Address to user is a many to one relationship. So we are covering here one to many, many to one relationship. Then come to user and a customer and employee table. One user can be a customer or employee. One user cannot be a customer, cannot be a customer and employee, right? So one user always can be a customer, one user always can be employee. So this is a one-to-one relationship. This user table and customer table, user table, employee table is a one-to-one relationship. One-to-one relationship. Then come to role table. Come to role table. One user can have multiple roles. For example, I'm working in a company. I act as admin. I act as an accountant. I act as a super admin. So I'm an employee of the company. I hold three different roles, accountant, super admin, and admin. Three, so one user can have a multiple role. Similarly, one role, in the company, we have a 10 roles, 10 different roles in the whole company. That each role, let's say accountant role, that accountant role, we can apply more than one user. I can apply to me as well as I can apply to Deepan, I can apply to Vaidishwaran. So one role can one same role can apply to multiple person. So this relation is a many to many. This relation is a many to many. Using many to many, we can join. Using this many to many, joining this two table using one more table. That table is called as a join table. That table is called as a join table. This role user having a role ID. That role ID coming from primary key of role table. User ID coming from user table, that is a primary key of user table. So this is a model we need to manipulate in our example. Okay. When you look at this data model, right? Customer table and employee table is a main. It's a main table. Whenever I save customer or whenever I save employee, I want to save same time user table, address table, role table. In single shot, I want to perform all the operation. In single shot, I want to perform all the operation. If you are not using JPA, if you are not using persistent framework in your project, this is not at all possible. For each and every table, we have to save to the database. In the case of legacy style, since we are using JPA, very effectively we can provide the relationship for each table. Through that relationship, we can save the data in the database very easily. Okay, I hope you understand this DB design. Now we'll go to the implementation part. I'll close this. You understand the design, right? Okay, I don't want to explain this in this project, it's already implemented, but I want to go step by step for better understanding. Okay, now I'm going to create a new project called user management. Okay, file, new project. The Spring Assistant is selecting this. Next. IT Garden, I'm saying IT Garden. Then project name is user-service. Version is 8 and project name is user-service. IT Garden, then users. I'm saying that user service. Okay. Package name is user service. Next, then web layer, Spring Web, then SQL. I need MySQL driver. Then I need a Spring Data JP. Two things I need, because I'm using a MySQL, so I selected MySQL driver. Then I want to use Spring Data JP. I think I don't want this JDBC API. The web layer selected Spring. What is this? Having some problem, I think it's not showing properly. Spring Web, then SQL, Spring Data JP, then MySQL. So it's deselected. I don't know why it's deselected. It's some problem in this plugin. Okay, I'll select. I want to use this, okay, right location only. Finish. New window. Starter.jpa, MySQL connector, and Starter Web. The three things are selected properly added here. Okay, now that based on this design, right? The design. I want to create 5 entity object. I want to create first. I don't want to make it refactor, rename, make it application. Okay, now new package, entity object, entity package, then Okay, from the entity package, I'll copy this everything. Okay, I don't want to create by manual. I copy this. Okay, get user, then user, I think now we don't have any error now. Customer is no error. Nothing. Okay, here. We have to use one here also. User. We are done now. See here now, user object. When you look at the user object, whatever columns in the database table, sorry, I don't want to be database table. Here I created email ID, password, first name and last name and user type. One more column, user type. I want to tell what is a user type, whether it's a customer or employee. Okay, this is a primary key. I am saying generation type equal to identity. That meaning I want to do the auto generation. I will explain tomorrow about this detail. But there are four types: auto, identity, sequence, and table. Okay. Now I am using identity because I am using auto generation key in a database table. Okay. Whenever you say identity, it will create automatically that particular primary key as an auto generation. Okay. Then this acts as a primary key because I am saying at ID saying primary key because of this particular strategy. How do you want to generate the primary key? I want to generate the primary key through auto increment. After creating this particular table, this ID column as auto increment column because of this identity attribute. Okay. Then email ID, password, first name, last name, user type. These are columns of my database table. Then in the diagram, I said that user table having a multiple address. User table having a multiple address. So here I am saying one too many. One too many means user is a one object. The current class is a user, right? Current class is a user. That object is a one. Many is what is a many address? What is a many address? That is the address table is a many. That meaning we have to say list object. We have to use one annotation called one too many for one too many relationship. We are saying that one too many. I want to use many object is the address. Since it's a many, we have to make it as a list object. One user can have a multiple address. 1 minute, somebody, people are starting by. Then I will tell about the first argument later. Cascade equal to cascade type auth. That is, whenever update, whenever delete, I want to delete the child record also. For that purpose, I'm saying cascade equal to cascade type all. Then mapped by equal to user. What is the meaning of mapped by user? So Here I am saying user is a one object and address is a menu object for this user. In this address object, we have to tell this user. Here we have to say many to one. This is a many to one, right? This is address is a many to one. User is a one to many. Now address is a many to one. So I am saying at many to one. At many to one, fetch type equal to lazy, cascade equal to cascade type equal to all. There are two types of fetch type. One is a lazy, another one is a eager. Lazy meaning at the time of request, at the time of request, it will populate the data. It will populate the data. That is the reason of me lazy. Lazy means we are not doing job correctly, right? At the end of the time, we are doing a job like that. Similar kind of that. Whenever populate this address object, it never populate the user object. Okay. Populate the child object. At the time of requesting, it will go and fetch the particular dependent class, dependent object value. That is called as a lazy. Eager is, it will load initially itself. First time itself, it load and keep it. That is called as a eager. Okay. Then cascade, here also you say cascade type equal to all. This is not related to JPL. Okay. This is not related to JPA. I will tell later why I am using this. Then join column. In this user table, here I am saying at join column name equal to user ID. Name equal to user ID means what I am saying is in this user object there is a one primary key column called ID, right? That ID should act as a user ID in the address table. Act as a user ID in the address table. Whatever address added by the particular user, those address data stored in here, then that user ID, that person user ID stored in user ID column of address table. User ID column of address table. That is the meaning of adjoint column. Using adjoint column, we can tell that which column from the address table you have to refer primary key of user table. Okay, that is the purpose of this. Okay, then that's it. This is the relationship we have given in the object level. Through JPA, we are giving the relationship through object level, user and the address. Then role. Each user must have one role. According to our example, each user must have one role. Here I am saying that many to many. This is a one user can have a multiple role. One role can have a multiple user. Okay. That is the concept of many to many. In a join table, I am saying at join table, name equal to user underscore role. That is whenever you map many to many call, many to many. That is whenever you relate a two table using many to many relationship, we need to create one more table called join table. I am providing what is the join table name, user underscore role. This table is created by JPA. Okay, I am not creating, just I am defining for user, for role, create one table, one join table called user underscore role. Then I am saying what is a join column. I mentioned what is a join table. Now I want to tell what is a join column. Join column, at the join column, you have to say, user ID. I want to create a one column called user ID in this user underscore role table. Okay. In this user underscore role table, I want to create a one column called user ID. That user ID refer from ID column of my user table. This ID column of my user table. That is a primary key column. We have to mention here primary key column. So this primary key column act as a user ID in the user role table. Then inverse join column means what is the your join table, actually role table. This is not here you have to say the through this attribute you have to mention your current object. I am saying this inverse join column, you have to tell what is a joint object. My joint object is a roles, right? That is whatever you are mentioning here. That is the that part, this particular object primary key we need to mention using inverse join column. Inverse join column or join column, I want to create one column called role ID. In this user underscore role, this ID coming from roles table, coming from roles primary key column. That is the meaning of inverse join column. Join column, you are saying the current object, that is a user object. Inverse join column, where you are mapping. I am mapping here role. So in the role primary key column, you have to tell using inverse join column. Through this way, I am joining user table under role table. User table under role table. Okay. When you say like that, what will happen? Whenever you start the application, you are implementing this project very first time, you don't have any table in the database. Whenever you start the application, based on this relationship, Hibernate create a database table based on this definition. Okay, I hope you understand about the user and the address table, address relationship. Okay, then come to our customer. This is a very simple relationship. Customer object, I have a customer ID is a primary key. Customer type, I can say customer type. I can say some types, type 1, type 2, type 3, whatever it is. That is our issue. Then customer profile, I keep being a customer profile as a string. Okay, actually in the real time, customer profile is another Java object. In this example, I'm keeping as a string. Then this is a customer to user is a one-to-one relationship, right? One-to-one relationship. So I'm saying at one-to-one annotation. Using at one-to-one annotation, just I'm saying cascade type equal to all. Cascade type equal to all. Then join column, which column you want to join. I want to create one column called user ID in this customer table. In this customer table, I want to create a user ID. In this column, I want to refer primary key of user object. Primary key of user object. What is a primary key here? ID is a primary key. Okay, so whenever I create the customer table using this object, it will create this column and it will create a one more column called user ID. In this user ID, we are keeping primary key of user table. Okay, very similarly, employee also. Employee also same thing, one to one. These are through this way only we have to relate in JPA. One to one, one to many, many to many, then many to one. In the roles also, we are saying that same thing. At many to many, what is the target class, user class, mapped by roles. Here I am saying one more attribute, mapped by roles. That meaning, this roles attribute defined inside a user. Defined inside a user. See, here I am mentioning roles. So through this way, I am relating the many-to-many relationship between user and the roles. Okay, now we have created an entity object. We have provided a relationship in the object level. In the object level through JPA, using annotation, one-to-one, many-to-many, many-to-one, many-to-one. Now, my expectation is based on this relationship, table should create in a database. Now I'm going to remove all the table from here. In the resource application.property, I need to configure. DB. Copy this, paste it here. That's it. Here already I mentioned server colon port 9191. Here also I mentioned, no need. Remove this. Here I am saying that my database is a training-db. Training-db. I'm closing this training admin connection. When you look at training-db, there is no table, nothing. Okay. Now I want to create a, I want to run server. Right click run. So here all the tables are getting created. Also, based on the relationship, it adding the relationship. Okay, it's happened. We'll check the database. See, here user role is created. User role I have not defined anywhere. The entity object, there is no class called user underscore role, right? Only I mentioned here only. Here I mentioned joint table is a user underscore role. So it's created a user underscore role. Then you say alter. I am addressed going to address table. Go to keeping alter command. In the if you say alter, this screen will open. In the foreign key, you can see the foreign key created. The foreign key in the address table at the referring user ID column referring an ID of user table. Reference table is a user. From that user table, it's referring ID column in the user ID table. So in the address table, whenever create a user object, that user address stored in address table, that corresponding user ID maintained in the user ID. Okay, like so based on our mapping, it creating a relation. In creating a relation in the database also. See the employee also, it's creating a relation. So like that, we create all the relation based on our mapping. The user, let's say, check the user role, alter table. The go to foreign key. See, here created two foreign keys. This is referring a ID table, ID column from the user table. This is referring an ID column from the role table. It's a joint table created. Okay, now we have a configured, we have mapped our objects perfectly. It's working as expected. The next step is we need to save. We need to add the data to the database. That is the next step. Whenever, okay, now I want to create a one controller class, controller package. So we'll come from repository, okay. What is the time? Still 15 minutes. New package repository. Then I want to get all the repository classes. Okay, I'll go into copy. Why we need to? Rest of time. Just I'll go into copy and paste it. So I created a for this entity object, this is five entity object, right? For five entity object, I'm creating a repository classes. For each classes, I'm creating a repository classes. Action from JP repository, I'm passing the corresponding entity object. Okay, JP repository is created completed. Then I want to create a one service class. That service class is a user. I want to create only one service. This service interact with all the repository classes. Okay. Package service, then copy and paste. I don't want to copy everything. Okay, I'm going to create a user service. User service, then at service. Okay, here first I want to perform only save operation. Okay, Okay, then here we have customer object. Okay. Auto wire private customer repository at auto wire private employee repository. Okay, what is this? Save customer repository, then customer repository. What is the customer repository? Extend JP repository. Okay. Okay. Here also we have to see this value and okay, now I have implemented the save customer, save method. Don't consider these lines. Okay, I will going to explain later. Don't consider these lines. Okay, now my intention is I want to save customer data. This will going to save the customer data. I will tell what is this later. Okay, now this is a service method. For this service method, we need to create one controller. The controller class is user controller. Okay, I will create a user controller. Just will copy this, I'll paste it here. New package controller, just paste it here. Then customer, I don't want I'm going to remove you. Okay. This is my base endpoint is API/users. From the users, if you want to save customers, you have to save customer. You have to call this. If you want to save employee, you have to call this. Okay. And then now, okay, we have defined that API. Now we need to design the JSON request. Right? JSON request we have to design. This is a complex object. Customer. Customer is the main object. Then inside a customer we have a user. Inside a user we have a address. Inside a address under we have a roles, right? Now based on this data structure we need to design the JSON request. That is a very very important. Okay. Go through our object. Based on that object we will decide. No problem. Why this error is coming? Now we'll design a customer JSON. Okay. Now customer JSON, we have a ID, customer type, and the customer profile user, right? First we'll go here, go to the editor. We have an ID, no need, it's auto generation. For saving purpose, we don't need ID. We don't have to pass ID. So we don't have to pass this ID from the client side. We're going to see use customer type. Customer type. I'm saying customer type underscore one. Then comma. Then customer profile. Colon customer underscore profile one. Okay, comma. What is next object? Next object is user, right? So for user, we have to say user. Whatever attribute available here, for that name you have to give. User colon, open the braces, close the braces. Then what is inside user? Inside user we have an email ID. ID we don't have to mention again. Email ID, then Suresh underscore customer one at gmail.com. Then what is next one? Password, right? Password. Okay, password you can pass here. 1, 2, 3. Then first name. Then first name is a Suresh. Then last name. Stalin. Then user type. Finally, then user type. User type. This is a user object, right? We don't tell what is the user type. User type is a, if we are generating a customer. So user type is a, I am saying is a customer. Actually, this is no need to pass from the client side. At the time of doing creating a customer in the backend system, do this operation, do this, set this data as a customer type. Okay, I don't want to mention from here. Then we need to populate the address for this particular user. So this address coming from user, right? So we need to set that address list. This is the array object. This is a here we can see is a list is array object. So we have to define as array object. To define array object, we have to mention braces. Then inside brackets we have to pass braces. What is the address object here available here? Address, we have an address one. Address, first address, address 2, second address, then we have city, state, country, mobile, right? We have city, Chennai, country, India, then mobile is a something, some number. Okay, now here again is a user object. I don't want to do here, I don't want to, because it's coming from user, right? It's coming from user, and inside user I'm saying address. Again, address referring the user, right? I don't want to enter this information. Okay, that's the reason I'm saying here add JSON back reference. I will give the better explanation later, not now. Okay, so now I define the customer object, customer data, I define the user data, I define the address data. One more thing we have pending. What is that? Inside the user, when you go to the user object, we have a roles, right? We have a roles. We have to mention these roles. So for that, there is another array object called as roles. Actually, these roles I don't want to pass from the client side. Role will be created in the backend system. Role will be created in backend system. Role will be populated in the backend system. So I don't want to mention roles from the client side. Okay, this structure is enough. So through this, we have to design our JSON structure based on Java object. So in this customer object, we have roles and we have address inside address, we have user, right? We are not defining that. We have to go through the object. Whatever you want, you need to define. Whatever data we can provide from the client side, that data only we need to define. Roles and all cannot passed by client side. Roles and all taken care by backend side. So I'm not passing the roles. Okay, now we have defined the data. Now I want to use this JSON structure as a request body from the client side. I want to send this data to store a customer data. Let's see if it's storing or not. Time is about 9. Okay, we'll see just 2 to 3 minutes, then we'll wind off. Rest you can see in the tomorrow. Okay. The reason is coming error here is I am not mentioning comma. You have to mention comma. Okay. Then here missed quote, double quote. Apart from that, it looks fine. What is the API I need to use? Still showing error. Why? Okay, go to user controller. Whatever object I am passing from here, this data will be populated in customer object. Populate customer object. That customer object I am passing to save customer class, save customer method from the user service. Here I am taking the this also no need. Here just I am passing a customer object here. Just I am passing customer object. Whatever data coming from here, just I'm taking that object, I'm passing it here. That's it. That's it I'm doing. Nothing else. I'll go to restart the application. Server started. I'll go to send a request now. Where is the postman? Yeah, postman is here. We're using write API customers. What is the endpoint? Write endpoint. API slash user then customers slash users. We have to pass users here. User slash customers. It gives some internal server error. Let's see what's that. Internal server error. Null property reference a null. IT guard on user type. It's expecting some value for user type. I am not setting some value user type, right? But user type is a mandatory we need to set. I commented out here. That should not be do like this. Okay. So I need to set user type. I cannot set from client side. I need to do the user type in customer in the backend side. So I am calling customer.getUser. Then set user type of. I am saying user type dot user underscore type underscore customer. This is a constant file which is coming from common package. When look at the constant file, you can say public interface constant. I am using interface. Generally, everybody use classes. Classes as a constant. That should not be. That is not a right way to use. We are using only variables, right? Why do you want to go with classes? Classes is a heavy object. Okay. We should not use heavy object for defining a variables. So better we can go with interface. So I'm using an interface here. That using that interface, I'm declared the type of users. Customer.getUser set user type customer constant.userType.customer I'm saying. Okay, that meaning I am setting a user type inside a customer object which is coming from the client side. Let's restart again. Okay, server started. I am sending again request. Still same error, some error. Because now what is the error? Null, again the same, null property references. Something is missed. Oh, in the address we have missed mobile. It's saying the very clearly right errors. Go to customer. So not here. We have to enter mobile from here. Go to postman. Let's check mobile is there or not. Oh, it's a spelling mistake. Mobile. So in this time we don't have to restart because it's a mistake from the client side. So we don't have to restart. I'm clearing the console. Send. Still same error. What is the mistake now? State. Oh, I missed state here. Okay. State colon TN. Hopefully this time it should work. Let's see. Yeah, I got the response. 201 creator. Whenever save, I am saying here, status as a creator. That's the reason it's giving the creator. Right? I got the response. I copy this response. I'll go into JSON viewer. The response data ID is generated. Whatever data coming, I pop that is coming here for user generated ID, then address also generated ID. Roles is a null. I'm not setting any roles in backend side. That's the reason it's giving null. Let's check the database now. Go to user table. So user is set, user ID is set 3, Suresh under customer 1, Suresh Stalin, Pafir 123, customer type, served. Now this user ID is set 3, right? Go to customer now. For user ID, for this customer, user ID is 3 is mapped. Okay. Then go to address. Address created, but when you see here, where this particular row not saying which is the user ID for this customer. This is not mentioning this customer, this after address belongs to which user ID. That is the one error. Okay, that is the one error. That will fix that. Okay, now you know what is that error. Okay, now based on the relationship, this data gets stored now. Okay, I am not doing anything in the code. In the code level, I am not doing anything. Just I mapped the entity object. Then I'm calling that simply. Where is that? I'm calling simply save customer. Then I'm simply passing customer object. Whatever object mapped to this customer, that object automatically gets stored in the database. I'm not doing much program here. Okay, this is the power of JPA. Okay, now we have to fix. Two things here. One is we need to store the user ID inside address table. Then we have to add roles to the particular user. That we'll going to see tomorrow. Also, we'll going to see various queries. How to perform a queries through JPA. Okay, that we'll going to cover tomorrow. Okay, I think already time is 9:05. When you look at this log, insert into user, insert into address, insert into customer. 3 insert queries get performed. Clear? Any question? Okay, guys, we'll talk tomorrow. Okay, I'll wind off now. Still not subscribe this channel, please subscribe it, share this video to your friend circle, click bell icon for regular updates. Thanks for watching this full video.